Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Ecosystem Economy, How to Lead in the New Age of Sectors Without Borders by Venkat Atluri and Miklos Gabor Dietz. Narrated by Jason Keller. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Limit of liability. Disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book, and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Neither the publisher nor author shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including but not limited to special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Further, readers should be aware that websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is read. Introduction: The Age of Ecosystems, Taking Stock of a Transformation in Progress. The future has never seemed more exciting or more confusing. When we look outside today, we are confronted with a multitude of exhilarating, sometimes vexing, and vitally important trends unfolding in the realms of culture, business, and technology. For the uninitiated, it all might seem overwhelming. Cryptocurrencies, artificial intelligence, Web 3.0, quantum computing, automated cars, the Internet of Things, smart homes, and biomedical miracles. The list goes on and on. What it adds up to is a kaleidoscope of overlapping, cataclysmic changes, all happening at once, each of which carries the potential to transform the world, and each of which is probably complex enough in its own right to spend a whole book contemplating. However, if we take a deeper look, if we cut through the noise, we can see something else. On closer examination, almost all of these dizzying developments unfolding in the world today are related to another phenomenon altogether. The phenomenon is this: the borders between the traditional sectors of our economy are fading away. We're used to thinking about the economy in terms of sectors like construction, real estate, information technology, automotive manufacturing, energy, financial services, and healthcare, to name just a few. We've always understood these sectors to be discrete categories, and each has traditionally operated in its own sphere. But now, the economy is changing on a fundamental level. And as the borders between sectors blur, new organizing structures are forming in their place. If this seems like an abstraction to you, consider this. Many businesses are already starting to adapt. This is more than just a theory. It's actually happening. The transition away from sectors is such a fundamental change, it can be difficult to wrap our minds around. We are facing one of the biggest market shifts in economic history. For our whole lives, we've understood our economy in terms of sectors. As we'll see in Chapter 1, the concept has been around for thousands of years. It seemed like the lines dividing sectors were carved into the very bedrock of the marketplace. They were considered not only real and tangible, but inescapable. Now, that is changing. Sectors are becoming a less and less compelling way of describing the economy because, increasingly, the borders between them are dissolving. Why is this? We'll spend a significant part of this book exploring this question. But for now, it will have to suffice to say that in the early 21st century, we hit a turning point that made it possible for businesses to ignore these borders and do something new, in the true interest of delivering value for all. What does this mean? In short, for many businesses, everything is changing. Their customers, their competitors, their business models. They will have to reinvent themselves to operate in an entirely different environment. As the borders between sectors fade, businesses are organizing into new, more dynamic configurations, centered not on the way things have always been done, but on people's needs. These new formations are what we call ecosystems, communities of interconnected digital and physical businesses that work across traditional sector boundaries to provide customers with everything they could want related to a particular need or set of needs, whether it's housing, health, or entertainment. Businesses form ecosystems by collaborating with one another, by sharing assets, information, and resources, and ultimately creating value beyond what would have been possible for each of them to achieve individually. These businesses are doing more than just finding new ways to slice the pie. By working together and working across industry boundaries, they are creating value propositions that actually expand the pie, that accomplish more collectively than each can individually. Because each business that takes part in an ecosystem contributes to this collective process of value creation, each also shares in the upside that is generated. The result is a dynamic, creative, powerful new kind of business formation that stands to transform the economy as we know it. Why do we use the word ecosystem to describe this sort of community? When we're talking about the natural world, we often use the word to mean a community of biological organisms that are interdependent, or which together form a web of symbiotic relationships that meet the particular needs of each organism. In a forest ecosystem, for example, we can imagine how this web would look. Bears eat the deer, while the deer eat plants that are fertilized by the bear's droppings, as well as decomposed leaves and other vegetation. The vegetation is converted into soil by worms, which are eaten by birds, which also eat small rodents, which subsist on tree nuts, which are sustained by the soil and decomposing vegetation. Each organism is dependent on the web that connects them all. Similarly, businesses can come together to create webs of mutually beneficial relationships centered on meeting customers' needs. The analogy is far from perfect. Of course, there are many differences between the workings of business ecosystems and natural ecosystems, but the core concept is similar enough to be instructive. Chances are, you've heard the term ecosystem thrown around quite a bit in a business context. The concept is widely recognized. Somewhat counterintuitively, this poses a bit of a problem. Because it is so frequently discussed and so commonly cited, there is a lack of clarity about its real meaning. And in many cases, people use the term to mean something much more limited and less meaningful than what we have in mind. There are CEOs today who will look at their traditional vendor and client relationships and fool themselves into thinking that this constitutes an ecosystem. When we use the term in this book, we use it to refer to much deeper connections between businesses, alliances that are about collectively creating and sharing value in the best interests of the customer. To better understand how and why businesses form these ecosystems, consider the supermarket. When we speak of ecosystems today, our thoughts tend toward high-tech businesses. But these companies have non-digital precursors from decades before the rise of the internet that illustrate the same core concept. Before the rise of supermarkets, families purchased their food from a wide range of different specialized vendors. Milk was delivered by a milkman. Fish came from a fishmonger, meat from a butcher, produce from a greengrocer, rice, beans, and other staples from a dry goods store. The innovation of the supermarket was to combine each of these previously separate functions into a single, comprehensive, one-stop source for all grocery needs. Rather than being organized by supply chain, as the older specialty shops were, the supermarket was organized according to customer needs. Customers did not want to visit 5 to 10 different vendors in order to do their shopping for the week. They did so because it was the only way they had ever known, and it was the only way to get the items they needed. It was the way food distribution had developed over years and years. What people truly wanted was simplicity, a one-stop shopping experience. As soon as the supermarket was introduced, it quickly became the dominant form. Today, with a big push from new technological advances, businesses are increasingly coming together to form comprehensive ecosystems that similarly cater to multiple needs simultaneously. essentially replicating the supermarket effect on a much larger scale. These pioneers are using digital platforms, both hardware and software, to spur innovation by organizing businesses into new collaborative forms, like app stores and digital marketplaces with innovative economic models. Think of a company like Rakuten in Japan, which offers loans, credit cards, fintech, travel booking, instant messaging, and food delivery. Or a company like Amazon in the United States, which offers music, video, gaming, cloud computing, supermarkets, and online retail. Or still others, like Apple, Tencent, Alibaba, or Google. Here's a challenge. Try to identify a single sector that each of these companies belongs to. It is an impossible task. The reason is that these are ecosystem businesses, and as such, they span multiple sectors. In fact, they are organized in a way that completely disregards the traditional borders between sectors. Of course, another kind of sector-spanning company has been commonplace for ages, the conglomerate. You might wonder how ecosystem companies differ from conglomerates. We'll tackle this question more fully in Chapter 1, but for now, the short answer is that ecosystems are centered on customer needs, whereas conglomerates are not, necessarily. As we'll see, there are different ways of being an ecosystem player. Some involve collaborating with select partners to build your business across sector borders in order to meet customer needs in a particular category or set of categories. Others involve working closely with many partners or facilitating a large platform on which other players can come together. The core concept, though, is that players are crossing sector borders in the service of meeting a set of customer needs holistically. To illustrate how ecosystems work, let's consider a few that are already making waves in the world today. For example, imagine an ecosystem focused on fulfilling customers' needs in the category of health. Think of the typical steps a person might take as they go about maintaining their health, choosing and managing a health insurance policy, receiving preventative care, getting prescriptions filled, choosing wellness activities like a fitness class, or services like a diet tracker, even receiving major treatments like a surgery, and managing the resulting insurance claims and bills. Together, these steps constitute the customer's journey. The idea of an ecosystem is to bring them all together, or rather to bring as many of them together as possible. Even if each step in that journey is fulfilled or managed by a different company, the ecosystem integrates them into a single platform so that from the customer's perspective, it's all one experience, one journey. Ecosystems are particularly effective and attractive to customers when they are able to solve critical pain points with tailored solutions. In other words, if an ecosystem can help customers through the most arduous step on their journey, they will be more likely to trust the broader ecosystem with the rest of their needs. At no time was this clearer than in 2020, at the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic, when millions and millions of patients experienced a new pain point, the inability to safely leave one's home to conduct routine business, like going to a doctor's office. This led to the rapid and widespread adoption of a service that had previously been considered very niche, telehealth. And as they adopted telehealth, consumers also became generally much more open to the idea of getting healthcare through ecosystem-based providers. But there are many other fundamental needs that can form the basis of an ecosystem. If the core need we're talking about is, say, the need for a home, the story would be a bit different. A home ecosystem would involve multiple companies coming together to meet every need a consumer might have in the process of obtaining and maintaining a home. Anyone who has been through that process, especially in recent years, knows how much of a headache it can be. It begins with the search. So an essential component of a home ecosystem may be a real estate and rental search engine like Zillow. Other needs include financing, insurance, inspection, appraisal, moving, renovation, legal issues, upkeep, and maintenance. If we were to imagine a comprehensive home ecosystem, it would incorporate each of these, Whether through a series of partnerships or through a digital platform that connects services from different companies into a single integrated experience. In either case, the end result for users would be a one-stop shop for everything home-related, from searching to buying to decorating to maintaining, all the way to selling, when it's time to move and begin the cycle all over again. Throughout all of it, customer needs come first. To take a slightly different example, let's think about businesses' needs as well as people's. Businesses, after all, are run by people and are likewise attracted to the prospect of having all their needs fulfilled in the same place. One business need that has become the basis for an ecosystem, for example, is the need for business-to-business, B2B services. Think of the typical operations services that small and medium enterprises, SMEs, might need help with. Getting funding. Managing finances, marketing, including digital advertising, IT infrastructure, legal advice, office management, and human resources. One commonality that unites almost all entrepreneurs is that they prefer to spend as little time on these tasks as possible. A B2B services or small business ecosystem, then, would be focused on delivering as many of these needs as possible for SMEs all together, perhaps through an all-inclusive digital platform. Hopefully, by now, the power of ecosystems is becoming clear. Once established, successful ecosystems create a virtuous cycle that fuels their growth. By offering products and services that individual companies could not create as effectively on their own, ecosystems draw in more and more customers and ultimately generate a network effect. More customers mean more data, which companies can leverage to fashion even better offerings, which in turn further improves the company's processes and wins more customers. As ecosystems bridge openings along the value chain, they create a customer-centric, unified value proposition in which users can enjoy an end-to-end experience for a wide range of products and services through a single access gateway. Along the way, customers' costs go down even as they gain new experiences, all of which whets their appetite for more. The stakes could not be higher. To understand why, try this. Look up the top 10 companies worldwide today in terms of market capitalization, then compare the list to the top 10 companies a decade ago or two decades ago. The lists will look completely different, of course, and that's to be expected. After all, times change. But if you take a closer look, you will notice something curious. In the past, this list was dominated by companies that were easy to classify. In other words, by non-ecosystem players. Oil and gas companies like ExxonMobil, insurers like AIG, and financial institutions like Citi. Today, although the list remains constantly in flux, you are likely to find that a significant majority of those top 10 companies are ecosystem players, companies that defy easy categorization because they work in concert with a community of partners to create value propositions that span sector boundaries. Among them, you are almost certain to see Apple, Microsoft, Alphabet, Amazon, and Meta. How would you classify these companies? To say they're tech companies would be an oversimplification. Apple offers credit cards and runs the App Store, which provides customers with everything from food delivery to exercise classes to ride sharing. Amazon runs a large chain of grocery stores and owns the movie studio MGM. The difference between the list of top companies in years past and today reflects a colossal economic reorientation, the significance of which is only now beginning to be felt. Already, capital markets are betting untold trillions of dollars on these ecosystem companies. But the enormous powers they currently wield today are just the tip of the iceberg. We believe that in the coming decades, the fundamental structure of the global economy will be recast into an entirely new shape. This carries a number of important consequences, the most significant being that a nearly incomprehensible amount of value is at stake. According to a recent analysis, This new breed of multi-sectoral, category-defining ecosystem companies, which comprise what we call the integrated network economy, could reach roughly one-third of global gross economic output, measured in revenues, over the next few decades. That's about $70 to $100 trillion. If you are interested in getting a piece of that $70 to $100 trillion, you will need to understand the fundamentals of the massive transformation currently taking place, which is exactly what this book aims to help you do. In the chapters that follow, we will explain why this transformation is happening, why it's happening now, how it is likely to continue unfolding in the decades ahead, and, most importantly, what you should do about it. If the $70 to $100 trillion isn't enough to convince you, perhaps this will be. You don't have a choice. This integrated ecosystem economy is coming whether you are ready or not. In fact, it's already here. And failing to act would be an enormous missed opportunity. There is a new set of rules, a new set of incentives, a whole new game to play. Continuing to play by the old rules will mean not only missing out on the rewards of the ecosystem economy, but facing disintermediation, disaggregation, commoditization, and invisibility, what we call the four horsemen of the apocalypse. The ecosystem economy opens enormous opportunities for creative business offerings, but also brings great danger. The upshot is that no one is safe. Most of today's big ecosystem players got their start by using technological advances to create new digital versions of businesses that had previously been conducted offline. In the process, they built a strong foundation from which to launch ecosystem-oriented businesses. But increasingly, as ecosystems become a more dominant force in our economic life, and the barriers between sectors continue to fade away, we are seeing an incredible breadth of ecosystem plays. New attacks will come not only from tech companies disrupting physical businesses, they could come from any direction. Large established companies leveraging their data and assets to break into new areas. Agile upstarts taking advantage of new technologies or regulatory changes. And companies you never in your wildest dreams would have expected to compete against. In short, incumbents aren't incumbents anymore. In fact, the very notion of incumbency is no longer relevant. Every company in the world, big and small, is going to have to gear up for a new kind of fight. If this sounds scary, that's because it should. To have any hope of surviving and flourishing in the coming decades, you will need completely new ways of thinking, new ways of formulating strategies, and new ways of executing them. The rules of this fight are entirely novel. For centuries and centuries, the basic organizing principle of discrete sectors remained a constant, and that basic fact touched every other aspect of economic life around the world. But now, that is changing. To win at this new game, in this new hyper-competitive economy, business leaders are going to need entirely new philosophies and new playbooks. The purpose of this book is to explain why these changes are happening and to give you the understanding and knowledge you need to navigate the new economy they are producing. Let's be very clear about this. There is no one tool that can prepare us for the ecosystem economy. We can't delegate ecosystem transformations to a chief data officer, CDO, alone, or to a chief marketing officer, CMO, or to a chief technology officer, CTO, or to any other single department. The ecosystem economy demands that we rework our entire approach to competition, and that we do it as a team, from the board and the CEO on down. It requires that we transform our organizations on a most basic level, that we rethink who we are as a company, where we compete, who we partner with, what value propositions we offer, how we execute our plays, how we create value in the broader ecosystem economy, and how we capture some of that value. This book will give you the tools you need to find meaningful, actionable answers to those questions. Because the coming of ecosystems is so transformative and so important, we want to be as direct as possible in telling you about them. For that reason, this book's organization is simple. The book is divided into two parts. In part one, we will tell you about the past, present, and future of ecosystems. We will explain how humanity finally began to break away from sectors, how a confluence of changing consumer patterns and technology breakthroughs created some of the first ecosystems, and how, in the coming decades, ecosystems will turn the world inside out before our eyes. In other words, why is this happening? Why is it happening now? And where do we think these changes are taking us? In part two, we will explore the real-world implications of these momentous changes and give you all the knowledge you need to adapt and stay ahead of the shifting landscape. Whether you're a CEO, an upstart entrepreneur, an MBA student, or anywhere in between, we will explain, in short, why these changes have created totally new rules of the game. The economy, of course, is always changing, and always has been. At many points in the past, during times of great upheaval or difficult transition, perceptive and forward-thinking business people have been able to stay ahead of their competitors by skillfully reading the signs and preempting the changes they herald. We hope our book will be able to help you do something similar in the years ahead. But this time, keeping ahead of the curve is even more important. The transformation we are witnessing now is not merely the next in a series of ordinary rearrangements. It is the biggest and most consequential economic change in recent history. There is simply no other option but to make sure you are ready. As we said at the outset, we are all living through a time of chaotic transformations at every level of society. These changes can be difficult to interpret and even more challenging to act on. But finding a way to make sense of them is vital. At its heart, this book's purpose is to cut through the noise and offer clarity in the face of these often confounding developments, to zoom out and show the bigger picture. For it is only by doing so that we can find a way to thrive in the coming ecosystem economy. Part 1. 1. Sparks of Magic. The Road from Sectors to Earliest Ecosystems. Let's start by going all the way back to the beginning, to humanity's earliest days, thousands and thousands of years ago. Back then, humans were nomadic bands of hunter-gatherers, striving for basic subsistence. Only slightly more capable than the hominids from the opening scenes of 2001 A Space Odyssey who discover the use of tools. Life was, as Thomas Hobbes famously put it in his Leviathan, nasty, brutish, and short. Think of everything that has happened since then. Humans developed agriculture and founded permanent settlements. We domesticated animals, learned to make metal, built cities, and developed sophisticated societies with thriving political and artistic cultures. The human lifespan tripled. The difference between what life was for humans then and what it is now is staggering. It is incalculable. And yet, if we look closely, we will see that there is one thing that has remained relatively unchanged over all these years, from the very beginning of organized work until very recently. This whole time, humans have been organizing their work into discrete categories that essentially functioned as sectors of the economy. As civilization grew more advanced and thus more complex, people needed to work to be more organized and efficient. The result was that, over time, the boundaries between these categories gradually became more and more delineated. When humans were nomadic hunter-gatherers, it made sense for work to be generalized. But as civilizations started to grow and flourish, people found they could accomplish more with less effort if they specialized and divided their work into separate designations. So, for example, the work of brickmaking was conducted separately from the work of shipbuilding, Just as the work of laying roads was separate from the work of farming, which was separate from the work of building dwellings or making pots. Each line of work was its own distinct activity, carried out by distinct practitioners who developed their work into an institution of sorts. As civilization continued to develop, differentiated forms of work became more sophisticated, more specialized, and more communal. In ancient Rome, they became formalized with the creation of what were called collegia, or professional associations. There was, for example, a college of woodworkers, a college of merchant mariners, a college of wine dealers, and a college of planters. In ancient China, a similar system developed. By the Middle Ages, guilds, a similar type of organization, had taken hold throughout much of Europe. By the time of the Industrial Revolution, in the late 18th and early 19th centuries, different industrial sectors, as we think of them today, had begun to form. There was, for example, a mining industry, and a textile manufacturing industry, and a glassmaking industry. Each had its own supply chains, its own forms of craftsmanship and expertise, its own specialized labor practices, and its own proprietary distribution. These differentiated industries didn't appear out of nowhere. Rather, they followed the same pattern that had been set by the guilds and the collegia before them, and the specialized lines of work going back as long as humans had been doing organized work to create value. But that's not to say that nothing changed. Over these thousands of years of history, there was a continuous, gentle, and slow evolution. Borders between these industries shifted. From time to time, certain industries no longer made sense and were eliminated. Think of the telegraph industry after the invention of the telephone. Other times, sectors would morph or merge or split. Companies or organizations that were doing one kind of work would branch into others when technological advances made it easy and efficient to do so. Or they would stop doing other kinds of work when someone else was able to do it better. At the same time, other sectors emerged that were newly needed because of the increasing sophistication of society, or newly possible because of technological breakthroughs. Take, for example, the automotive industry, which coalesced in the late 19th and early 20th centuries as engineers refined and improved the internal combustion engine. Or the computer and information technology industry, which began to take off starting in the 1970s with the proliferation of the personal computer and new advances in the field of microelectronics. But by and large, even as old industries fell and new ones arose, these categories were distinct and stayed distinct. Now, thanks to a confluence of developments, this is finally changing. We'll explore why in the next chapter, but for the time being, what is important to understand is that sometime in the early 21st century, the borders between sectors started blurring. As we mentioned in the introduction, new formations called ecosystems are now taking their place. Businesses are coming together into dynamic communities that cooperatively create value by working across traditional sector boundaries. While all of this is incredibly consequential, it's also true that, in some ways at least, the emerging ecosystem economy may not seem so novel. After all, industry definitions have always been fluid. For centuries, really, technological developments have prompted sectors of the economy to appear, disappear, and merge. Banking, for example, was born from the merger of money exchange, merchant banking, savings banking, and safety deposit services. Supermarkets, as we mentioned earlier, emerged by combining the previously separate functions of butchers, dairies, fishmongers, greengrocers, and others under one umbrella where customers could get all of the grocery items they needed. Over time, changes such as these created new competitors, shifted vast amounts of wealth, and reshaped significant parts of the economy. Though they happened long before the term disruptive was in vogue, it could be fairly applied to these shifts. All of this might lead a person to ask, do ecosystems really represent such a radical break from the past? Is the new business world really that different from the old? The truth is that while we have seen flickers in decades past of the magic that ecosystems can work, what we have witnessed in recent years and are still witnessing is something truly new and special. The ongoing digital revolution, which has been reducing frictional transaction costs for years, has accelerated as the 21st century has worn on and is on the verge of triggering massive economic changes on a scale not yet seen. To understand the importance of this new ecosystem economy and how to take on the challenges it poses, we must first understand how it differs from the economy that preceded it. That is to say, we need to understand the beliefs and assumptions that have been guiding us all this time. It is important, therefore, that we take a moment to look back at the economic history that led us to this moment, the history of how we have evolved from a sector-based economy to an ecosystem-based economy. Sectors, of course, are groups of businesses that together occupy the same segment of the economy and offer raw materials, goods, or services within the same category. These sectors, or industries, are all around us. Though opinions vary as to the difference between sectors and industries, we will use the terms interchangeably here. It's not difficult to think of some examples. Farming, automotive, hospitality, financial, education, the list goes on and on. What is happening now is that these categories are losing their meaning as businesses form new communities that reach across traditional sector boundaries. As we'll explore in part two of this book, surviving the transition from the traditional sector-based economy to a new ecosystem-based economy will require a significant shift in the way you think about your business. In the old world of sectors, you typically measured your success in terms of sectoral market share and relative profitability. The goal was to own the largest possible slice of your industry. Within the emerging world of ecosystems, the goal is to own your customers, to follow and guide them on their journey and build a model that serves their needs at critical junctures. The difficulty is that industries and their borders have been with us for so long that they have become deeply ingrained in our thinking, a fundamental part of how we understand the world. Indeed, they are important to everyone, not just as a frame that economists and business leaders use to inform their analyses and decisions. Most industries have worked explicitly to create a community around their common purpose and line of business, with industry conferences, industry forums, industry publications, newsletters, meetings, even shared norms and ethical practices. For many workers today, their industry and the community that surrounds it are hugely important parts of their lives. The upshot of all this is that even though we're increasingly living in a world where traditional sectors of the economy are blurring, we seldom stop to ponder the fact of their existence, or to consider what their absence might look like. The rise of conglomerates. As we try to understand the evolution of the ecosystem economy, it may be helpful to consider the history of a related, but importantly distinct, kind of business, conglomerates, or firms made up of multiple unrelated or only loosely related lines of business. As the economy became more and more complex over the years, companies and organizations expanded, and many started to branch out more and more, taking on new areas that were beyond the scope of what they originally set out to do. Other conglomerates formed by consolidating several different businesses together under one common owner. As the Nobel Prize-winning economist Ronald Coase pointed out, the reason companies exist is to cut down on transaction costs, and in many cases, such savings proved attractive enough to warrant bringing together an extremely varied collection of business activities under one corporate roof. This was the impulse that gave rise to conglomerates. One of the earliest examples of this sort of sector-spanning conglomerate was the Dutch East India Company. Founded in 1602, the company, known by its initials in Dutch, VOC, for Vereeniging Oostindische Compagnie, existed for almost 200 years. As the historian Stephen Brown writes, by the late 17th century, the VOC was the most powerful and richest company in the world, and was involved in a multitude of commercial activities, such as construction, sugar refining, cloth manufacturing, tobacco curing, weaving, glassmaking, distilling, brewing, and other industries. Whereas many later conglomerates would form as individual families or business groups accumulated more wealth and power, the formation of the VOC was directed by the Dutch government. At the time, roughly 20 Dutch syndicates had been competing to import goods such as nutmeg and cloves from Southeast Asia. The Dutch government, worried that too much competition among these groups would drive down profits, worked out an arrangement to consolidate the rivals into a single company, to which it granted a government charter and a monopoly on the spice trade. Although the VOC was a monopoly in this sense, its primary purpose was still to integrate various different lines of business across sector boundaries. Before long, with its massive size and exclusive access, the company was dominating trade to the region, and, like its latter-day conglomerate descendants, it was branching into new areas in an effort to diversify its operations and revenue sources. In its effort to establish the Dutch as the undisputable worldwide leader in the spice trade, the Dutch government gave the company a broad set of powers, permitting it to make its own treaties, establish fortified outposts, and command its own army. By the 1700s, the company had undergone a series of changes, gradually morphing from a corporate entity into something more resembling a state or an empire. At the same time, the margins on the VOC's most important export fell. This, combined with social and political changes in Europe and poor management, gradually put the company on a downward trajectory, which culminated in the Dutch government revoking its charter in 1799. In subsequent years, conglomerates continued to evolve. It wasn't until the 20th century, however, that the circumstances arose in the U.S. for the conglomerate to become a common and widespread form of corporate organization. In the early years of that century, a series of developments unfolded that created an ideal environment for conglomerates. According to a scholarly article on their rise and fall in the U.S., companies such as DuPont and General Motors in the 1920s pioneered the use of multi-divisional form, or M-form, to produce and market a number of related products through separate divisions. The multi-divisional structure allowed easy integration of acquired businesses, which enabled firms to grow through acquisition. But after Congress passed an antitrust law known as the Seller-Kefauver Act in 1950, horizontal and vertical acquisitions, buying competitors, buyers, or suppliers, fell out of regulatory favor, and firms seeking to grow through acquisition were forced to diversify into other industries. This led to a period of frenzied mergers and acquisitions in the 1960s and 70s, which included the establishment of multinational conglomerate entities, such as the International Telephone and Telegraph Company, ITT, Litton Industries, Textron, and Gulf and Western. The boom was also helped by an environment of low interest rates and a somewhat turbulent up-and-down market. Companies had plenty of opportunities to buy other companies that had fallen on hard times, and they had access to easy financing thanks to the low interest rates. As a study in the Journal of Business and Technology Law explains, conglomerate activity dominated during this period. In 1968, at the height of the wave, about 84% of the large mergers were of the conglomerate type. Moreover, conglomerate acquisitions accounted for more than $11 billion of the $12.6 billion in assets acquired through large acquisitions of manufacturing and mining firms during the same year. In addition to the regulatory changes and the propitious business environment, something of a bandwagon effect may have contributed to the craze. But whatever the reasons, corporate leaders quickly became convinced of the effectiveness of conglomerates. The exception was the University of Chicago view that risk diversification was more appropriately undertaken by investors rather than by companies. As the Journal of Business and Technology Law study states, at the time, many of the leading executives believed that corporate diversification, through the acquisition of related and unrelated business, would establish a large corporation with increased efficiency and reduced potential risk. The idea was that corporations could more easily and effectively manage a number of unrelated businesses through the use of the resources and administration of a single large corporation, and this would both mitigate risk and prompt synergistic growth. If a large corporation simultaneously had business operations in, say, energy, air travel, plastics, telecommunications, and electronics, then it would be in a safer position if any one of those sectors were to fall into a period of difficulty. Conglomerates mitigated risk by diversifying into a wide variety of different sectors. Similarly, if they found success in one sector, they could use the proceeds to invest in other areas. Finally, these companies found that their diverse portfolio of business could boost the performance of their leadership talent as well. New executives would be cycled through different lines of business, from which they would gain an invaluable and diverse set of skills that would ultimately redound to the company's advantage. One such conglomerate that rose to prominence in this area was the International Telephone and Telegraph Company, ITT.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.